I'm Davey Alleman. I'm excited to share with you what to do after you've removed all of your caries or your crack in this particular case to make a deep defect now a super gingival situation that is a lot easier to manage both clinically and also for the patient. When we train a doctor, oftentimes we talk about the 3D problems where you're dealing with either a deep box, deep cracks, or deep decay. Each of these have unique challenges, but one thing that they have in common is that we are now below the gum tissue. We have to ensure that we have proper isolation so that when we use our adhesives, we don't have any contamination. And as we rebuild these areas where we've dissected a fracture, removed decay, or removed an old leaky restoration, we can now have complete control over our marginal quality and also ensure that we have a good seal. Now, how you fill these defects can determine whether you have gingival inflammation, where you're seeing some kind of chronic inflammation of the gingival tissue, or if you have something that begins to heal and create a long junctional epithelial attachment. Now, the old dogma of biologic width invasion really is challenged when we do a proper deep margin elevation. When we do a proper deep margin elevation, our seal is on the nanometer level, which is too small for a bacteria to physically enter and create a chronic inflammatory response of the soft tissue. Now, traditional dentistry will have gaps on the micron level that are large enough for bacteria to accumulate and create a cascading effect of inflammation, which most dentists have seen underneath an old leaky crown that is approaching crestal bone. This has made many dentists hesitant to embrace the idea of a deep margin elevation. Now, this is not a new concept. This was introduced in the literature back in 1998. And as we've continued to follow these cases over the last 2.5 decades, we are beginning to feel more confident that there is a myth or a dogma of biologic width, and that if you do your adhesive protocols properly, you will have a healing, and this will eliminate the need for crown lengthening surgery in many cases. Now, let's focus on what we see here in this image. Right now, we have a crack-free peripheral seal zone. The distal fracture is right on crestal bone. As you can see, I've packed Teflon between the dam and the tooth, and this is creating a separation of the PDL fibers, which will become very important as we do a matrix-in-matrix technique with very specific bands. Now, we've all been frustrated using a traditional Toffelmeyer or an auto matrix or a sectional matrix, where as we've placed this in this deep box, that as soon as we put any apical pressure, the band crumbles. And so I can very distinctly remember my first frustration with a case like this. This was about 3 years out of dental school. I was restoring a tooth that was endodontically treated. And no matter how many bands I used, I could not get the band seated deep enough. This created a lot of frustration. I was actually meeting with a former dental faculty to go watch a baseball game, which was 3 hours away. And as I was driving, I was just mad. I was so angry. I was so frustrated that I couldn't get the adaptation that I needed to ensure that I didn't have any crevicular or blood contamination on my seal. As I watched the baseball game with my friend, you know, he simply just put his arm around me and said, "You know what, Davey? Sometimes dentistry can be really, really hard. Don't beat yourself up over a case that didn't go quite as ideal as you initially thought." Now, that made me feel a little better, but as I was driving back that 3 hours after the baseball game, I was still just kind of fuming. I was so frustrated, and I'm sure each of you have felt that feeling as you're driving back from work where you're just like, why didn't I become a pharmacist? Or why don't I just manage a McDonald's? Now, I did remember from a couple years previous, I was working at a dental clinic where they were consolidating and they were getting rid of a lot of old supplies. And I saw a box of copper bands. And while I was in dental school, a good family friend, a dentist that we trained, and a dentist that I work one day a week with, he said, there's just nothing better than a copper band to seal a really deep margin. Now, I'd never seen that done when I was assisting with my dad, so I wasn't quite sure, but I knew that those copper bands might come in handy later in my practice. And as I was driving back from the big city to a smaller city, just a light bulb went on. And I said, Davey, what if you tried just cutting the copper band and just pushing on it? See if that distorts less than a stainless steel band. And I haven't found a better material to push a band that approaches crestal bone, because it's very, very resistant for apical pressure, but it's also very malleable to adapt for either a convexity or a concavity. You still want the preparation to be relatively flat, as you see here, but you can also see that it does conform as I use a stabilizing matrix. In this case, it's a Garrison real tight deep margin elevation band, but this could be an auto matrix. This could be a modified Teflmeyer. It doesn't really matter. It's just stabilizing the copper. Now, when you do a deep margin elevation, just banding it is the first battle. And after you've done that, you're going to place an adhesive. Now, this adhesive has a bond potential. Remember, you could be bonding to anywhere between 3 or even up to upwards of 6 different substrates that have different levels of hydroxyapatite that influence the composite movement. So as I place my adhesive in this particular instance where there's not a lot of decay, I'm thinking in this deep box, perhaps I'm getting 30 to 40 megapascals at its maximum. On the superficial dentin that is caries free, I'm getting a bond strength of about 50. The deep dentin on the pulpal floor, right around 40 megapascals, and the enamel, 30 megapascals. Now, this is just a bond potential. This is what the manufacturers tell you that you can achieve if you just switch over to their product. In order for us to maximize our bond strength, we have to understand the concept of an adhesive equation, where our bonds are directly in competition with the overlying polymerization stress of our restorative material. So as we reinforce our immediate dentin sealing with a resin coat, we need to ensure that this is thin. And so as the flowable resin is placed on top of your immediate dentin sealing, this ensures that you have full polymerization of your adhesive, where the oxygen inhibition has been completely neutralized, and also we're not having problems of pulpal fluid entering our bonding field from transudation. The resin coat needs to be thick enough to polymerize, but thin enough to prevent unwanted polymerization stress. So as we continue the process, we will need to analyze, does this preparation have high, medium, or low C factor? C factor, when it's ignored, creates a loss of bond strength upwards of 50%. So instead of 50 megapascals or 40 megapascals, you're getting 25 or maybe even only 20 megapascals. So how you mitigate the stresses in this dissection will be different than in the rest of the preparation, which looks relatively flat. An easy way to analyze C factor is to say, does it look like a plate, a bowl, or a cup? In this preparation, the majority of it looks like a plate, but in the crack dissection, that looks kind of like a cup. So we have medium to high C factor in the dissection. And this is an area that as we layer, we need to make sure that we're using thin increments. For your deep margin elevation, you will elevate this to be equigingival or slightly supragingival before you take your impression or take your digital scan. If you'd like to learn more about deep margin elevation, the creation of a biobase, and understanding bond potentials, we highly encourage you to check out our training programs on our website and in the description below.